By 2025, Generation Alpha will become the largest generation. Shaped in a digital and visual world, Gen Alpha are different to previous generations, but how are they viewed among the other generations? This was the focus of one of our latest Insights reports and is what we will be discussing today. My name is Holly Schaaf, and I will be the host for today's podcast, allowing Ashley Fell, our feature report host and director of advisory at McCrindle, to jump into the guest seat once again to talk about these insights. So welcome back again, Ash, to the podcast as a guest.
Thank you so much, Holly. Delighted to be in the guest seat once again.
It's very exciting to have you in the guest seat once again, talking about some very interesting recent insights that we released from this report, and just excited to dive right into it. So Ash, why don't you tell us a bit about this study and why we decided to conduct it?
So basically at McCrindle, we have the great privilege of kind of delving into topics that our clients commission us to work on. And then quite a few times actually throughout the year, we conduct studies that we get to decide the topic of. It's kind of off our own bat is the colloquial kind of phrase, where we go, okay, we want to investigate this. We want to find out more about how the world's perceiving Generation Alpha, who we've done a lot of research about. And that is exactly why we decided to make this latest kind of McCrindle Insights report, which is pretty much exclusively available for our McCrindle Plus subscribers, which is our new kind of subscription all access platform to all of our content. So this is kind of a little bit of an extra piece of research and insights that we're going to be talking about today. But I guess even prefacing that, which is a bit more of the methodology and why we've chosen this topic, just more broadly, you know, we know that interest in Generation Alpha has been increasing. Next year, they're going to be the largest generation in our world. They've got incredible influence beyond what we have seen with previous generations. And I remember writing this quote in our Generation Alpha book, where we said, every generation creates change, but occasionally the times and the trends collide, and a generation has enormous impact and shapes the culture beyond all measure. The boomers experienced it in the 1960s, Gen Y saw it in the early 2000s, and it seems that Generation Alpha are at the forefront of another such time. Mm-hmm. So it's always kind of interesting, and I guess Generation Alpha are young. They're described those 14 years and under today, and they can be quite difficult, just kind of methodologically, to access, because they are quite young. It's very easy to survey 18-year-olds and over, but when you're trying to access even 16-year-olds, like, it can be a bit more difficult, expensive in terms of a methodology standpoint. So we wanted to kind of understand how the older generations viewed Gen Alpha, and it's quite interesting to kind of track that over time. So basically, we ran this online survey back in July of this year of 1,000 Australians, and we also segmented these questions by those who have or know a Gen Alpha in their life. And I remember being involved with the team and helping them formulate this study. And we were like, yeah, we want to understand how other generations view Gen Alpha, but we also wanted to ask a question that allowed us to segment the responses by people who know and have a Gen Alpha in their life, because they're going to be able to weigh in a lot more than those who don't know any young people under 14, rather than just going, well, these are the stereotypes of young people. I don't know any, but they're always doing this and doing that. So we were like, well, we want to be able to compare those who are parents, those who are aunties and uncles, who are, you know, childcare workers or educators. And so the other aspect of this is that across Australia and across this survey, we found that almost 2/3 of the population, so 62%, have at least one Gen Alpha in their life, with 38% having no direct connection to this generation. And of course, in their key family forming years, Generation Y are the most likely to have a connection to Gen Alpha, with 42% having a Gen Alpha child and 71% having a connection to Gen Alpha in some way. So that's a bit of the background and how this study came about.
Yeah, that's great, Ash. And it's very interesting. Even I was just thinking there, reflecting on, I've been working at McCrindle just under 2 years now. And I think because we put so much emphasis, of course, in the research that we're doing on generations, it's a real topic of interest around here, as I'm sure our longtime listeners are well aware of. And given the fact that our principal and founder, Mark McCrindle, did coin Gen Alpha, which I'm also sure lots of you would be aware of. But I just find it interesting to reflect upon, even just under 2 years ago when I started and kind of got a lot more into the generational space, learning about Gen Alpha, I definitely wasn't as aware of this generation, certain traits, much about them. Would have still thought that they were babies and not, you know, getting into their preteen years. years. But it's really interesting, even just over the last couple of years, seeing the amount of dialogue, like the increase in the amount of dialogue about Gen Alpha, whether that's in the media, whether that's on even my own personal TikTok page, seeing where what used to be, you know, millennial slang versus Gen Z slang is now Gen Z slang versus Gen Alpha slang. It's definitely, there's lots more going on there on both social media. Brands are, you know, becoming a lot more aware as we've seen and know, and just tracking in the media, there's a lot more conversation around it. So it's a very timely report to put out and to talk about, which of course we're very interested in as well. But kind of thinking about that, Ash, and perceptions around Gen Alpha from this report, what words or phrases are people of other generations most likely to assign to this youngest generation, Gen Alpha?
So the way that we conducted this particular part of the questionnaire, why did I say questionnaire? We don't call it that, survey. Like, what the heck? Part of this survey question was, we asked, what words or phrases would you use to describe Gen Alpha? And we gave the respondents 18 options, and then we allowed them to select all that they feel apply. So it didn't have to be the top three or the top one. So again, different ways that you can conduct surveys and kind of get answers. And 18 options. I was contemplating when I was prepping for this whether I would read them out or not. I've decided to read them out, and then I'll let you know kind of which one came out at the top. So we've got the words we gave them were hardworking, generous, entrepreneurial, conservative, strong interpersonal skills, resilient, health conscious, consumeristic, disconnected, selfish, environmentally conscious, fragile, socially conscious, poor social skills, intelligent, entitled, anxious, and tech savvy. So they were the options we gave. And the most overwhelming answer that people selected was tech savvy. So that last one I said, which was 53% of survey respondents selected that term to describe Gen Alpha. So that was overwhelmingly the top answer, which I reflect on every time we ever run surveys or focus groups, even back to the Gen Alpha book days, and we would ask people, how do you think this youngest generation, how are they different to generations of young people in the past? And everyone always, I think, defaults to technology and how that has shaped them and their outlook and their life. So that would have been in line with what I would have suspected.
Yeah.
The second most common answer was kind of tied for second place in terms of percentage-wise. So anxious, 26% selected that, and entitled, 26% also selected that. Yeah. And I think it's interesting with anxious, and the other aspect that was fascinating because, and this is why I prefaced it in the earlier part of this, was that we wanted to be able to segment those who have a Gen Alpha in their life compared to those who don't have any connections with anyone in this generation to see if there are stereotypes or how true they are. And it was fascinating because those who have a Gen Alpha in their life are more likely to say that this generation and to describe them as anxious than those who don't. Yeah, so 32% of people who have a Gen Alpha in their life were likely to describe them as anxious compared to 16% who have no direct connection. So you would imagine those who have a Gen Alpha would be able to probably weigh in a little bit more accurately about describing them. And I wanted to just make a note on this because there is a text doing the rounds. I haven't read it, but it's been recommended to me. It's called The Anxious Generation, and a lot of teacher friends of mine are kind of investigating that and reading it. And I don't want to profess to be a clinical psychologist and move out of our area of expertise, but there are probably a number of factors that could contribute to this perception of Gen Alpha being anxious and also whether they are or not. And I think one of them is the pandemic and the impact it had and the restrictions which were happening in these kids' lives at really important formative stages that could have contributed to heightened anxiety among younger children. I guess there's, at the time of this global pandemic, there's also a general consensus as well among the other generations from this study that COVID would have a negative impact on Generation Alpha's mental health. We ran a study about that, and many generations, especially the younger ones, predicted that it will have a negative impact. You can talk about social media and technology and not getting outside as much. So there's lots of different maybe causes or reasons why. And even just that we're talking about this language more and that young people are able to identify as anxious and there's more discourse and language around mental health. So anyway, there's lots of different reasons why that could be happening. But some of the other words I'll just run through quickly. So as I mentioned, same percentage said entitled. And then we had 25% intelligent. So yay for a positive word for the Gen Alphas, intelligent. 25% also said poor social skills, 22% socially conscious, 22% fragile. And then we had about 20% saying environmentally conscious and selfish. So some keywords there. And then I guess down the bottom of the list we had the least likely words that people assign to Gen Alpha is hardworking, entrepreneurial, and conservative, which I know it sounds negative, but I guess if people, especially if they know really young Gen Alphas, they're probably not seeing these characteristics in them yet.
Yeah, sure, yeah.
Like you're more probably likely to see entrepreneurialism in Gen Z who are school leavers and thinking about their work and career, and these are kids. And again, when we're talking about a whole generation, especially with Gen Alpha, you do have some who are literally 1 year old and then you have 14-year olds. So it is quite a span. We could probably even segment this and look at 0 to 5 year olds and 5 to 10 year olds and, you know, teens and even the different life stages that exist within this kind of point in their life. But yeah, tech savvy, anxious, entitled, intelligent, and poor social skills, which are not the most positive. But I also wanted to, I guess, draw on this quote, this famous quote from George Orwell, which says, every generation imagines itself to be smarter than the one that went before and wiser than the one that came after. So this intergenerational kind of, those young people are this and the kids today are this, that's pretty common. Yeah. So I think keeping that in mind as we look at how people perceive Gen Alpha is also helpful, because our goal is never to kind of like diss this generation or speak badly about them, but actually to empower them and encourage them, which I think is a really important part of the role that we have, whether we're adults or friends or parents or aunties or uncles or teachers, to help them thrive.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, very interesting, Ash. And it's really, you get a real insight about that perception through those words as well. I mean, I would have guessed tech savvy is number one also. And I don't think anxious and what was the third one again?
It was entitled.
And entitled would be too far off. But I think even what you mentioned there around the Anxious Generation book, my husband and I on our we were away recently and we're just actually having a conversation about that book and about Gen Alpha, and just I don't know how it came out. Maybe it's just outside of work, it's all in my subconscious as well, just to talk about Gen Alpha. But we were just reflecting on some of those external factors that you mentioned before, just around COVID, pandemic, different how technology has advanced, social media particularly, what that looks like, how that's impacting and contributing to maybe more of that anxiousness. And it's just even interesting as a Gen Z, so the generation, you know, one generation from them, to reflect on, you know, the emergence of technology in my generation, where I can remember a life without technology. Like, obviously we had technology, but without social media particularly, and without like handheld iPhone sort of thing. I remember that coming about. But then also it's been such a formative part of my earlier kind of teen years and later kind of childhood years. Whereas with Gen Alpha, it's like this, it's been, they're so been so formed in that technology that it's going to be really interesting to see how that, being the first generation that's been fully, you know, developed in the 21st century with social media, with these kind of technology devices, how that's going to contribute. But I think that makes a lot of sense then where tech savvy becomes number one, right? Is that it's like, of course, they're going to be really good at navigating these different technologies and different things because that's all they've known. And I guess it's even interesting to reflect on the difference between these formative kind of factors that make up into the generation versus life stage. So I just kind of wanted to chat a little bit about that, Ash, and just how do current generations, would you say, how do they compare to their own generation as children? How would we compare that to Gen Alpha today?
So we investigated this as well in the study, and the question was, do you believe Gen Alpha exhibit these qualities more or less than your own generation did when you were under 15? So we're trying to get the respondents to think about themselves when they were young and their own generation. So whether we're talking to Gen X, Millennials, Gen Z, trying to compare your life as a 15-year-old or under to the children of today who are 15 and under. And basically we gave them, again, quite a number of different options to kind of agree with or see more or less than when they were 15. So when comparing Gen Alpha to their own generation at the same age, 91%, so the vast majority of Australians, agree that Gen Alpha is more digitally engaged. And even among Gen Z, for, exactly as you just mentioned, Holly, for whom technology was integrated into their and your life from an early age, 90% of Gen Z believe that Gen Alpha has a higher level of digital engagement than they did at the same age. And when you were talking before, I was just thinking about how oftentimes we talk about Gen Alpha experiencing it in their formative years. We talk about Gen Z experiencing it in their formative years, but Gen Z, as you alluded to before, many will remember a time before they had iPads and phones, but Gen Alpha will not know a world without the iPad because they began being born the same year that the iPad came into our lives as consumers. So it is like their parents, and they've been using it from before they can even remember. So that does, I guess, again, probably equate to this vast majority going, well, the digital engagement is the key difference between young people today compared to when we were young. Interestingly, Gen Alpha is also seen to be more concerned with their physical appearance than other generations. So 81% said they were they thought that Gen Alpha were more concerned with their appearance than previous generations. Wow. And this perceived focus on physical appearance is significant, given Gen Alpha is the first generation to grow up in a world where social media has always existed and with exposure to these platforms often occurring from a much younger age than any generation who has gone before them. So that was quite interesting. And I believe that you and I have talked about this, Holly, even just that of the trend of the younger generations with the girls and the boys and the Sephora and the cologne. And it is interesting to see maybe that the media exposure of even those trends is probably playing into this idea that these young kids are concerned with that physical appearance. I have heard people talk about social media even as kind of, especially whatever age you were when you got it, you had to become your own kind of personal brand manager. What image you're putting out to the world and how that's perceived, and will it get enough likes, and is this XYZ enough, whatever the trend is at the time. And every generation who has had social media has had to face that. But again, with the alphas from the youngest of ages, because they began being born the same year Instagram launched. So it is kind of interesting with that. And also Australians are recognising a higher level of social and global awareness among Gen Alpha, believing that they exhibit a higher level of environmental awareness and mental health awareness than the other generations had at the same age. And people are least likely to believe that Gen Alpha exhibits a higher preference for adventurous play, persistence to solve a problem, or respect for authority than the previous generation. So they were some that we started to see more people saying young people today are less likely to have respect for authority than we were when we were young. Yeah. They're less likely to have that persistence to solve a problem than we were, and that less likely to kind of involve in that self-directed play and adventurous learning. And again, you think about the context and you hear about older generations, and I hear a lot of people, you know, talking about like my parents even, like, oh, we got to stay out, play in the street and down the park, and now you're not allowed to go out for this, and there's higher focus on safety and protection. And so yeah, the context there shaping these various generations is also fascinating to consider in terms of how that's affecting their behaviour and also kind of comparing across the generations.
Yeah, really interesting. And even that connects to what you were just sharing there, particularly around, you know, the previous generations having more of that outdoor explore play experience versus, you know, even things like, is it Roblox is the big gen? And it's more like they're engaging with it, with that sort of, it's more interactive, I guess, those sort of platforms where you can go on and you're almost building this virtual world in a sense. But then also, like what you mentioned before, where, you know, on Instagram or other social media platforms, you're almost your own brand manager. It's very, that connects very much to that conversation I was having with my husband as well, just around, I think it kind of started a bit more around how, when would we, you know, introduce technology to our future children, which is an important question to, I guess, be thinking about. And that's where we got on the topic of The Anxious Generation and that book. And it's just really interesting to think about how even for us both, once again, touching on what I said before on Gen Z earlier on in life, being able to kind of distinguish that experience that they had before social media versus after social media, where it's really interesting how now with Gen Alpha, because they maybe don't have that same perhaps experience or knowing what it's like to not maybe have, your personality or appearance or all those sort of things be formed outside of the social, virtual social realm, and what impact that that would naturally have on you and the emphasis that it, you know, would put on your physical appearance. It's really fascinating what you're saying there about physical appearance, emphasis on that, and on social awareness, because you can see a very clear connection there with things like social media, where you have so much, you know, global connectivity. I know we talk about them being the most globally connected generation because it's they have access to so much information, maybe at times too much information, you know, when it comes to social mm-hmm. media, but also that emphasis on physical appearance and how are you being perceived by your friends and what, how, you know, do you glow up, as, you know, people might say online and stuff as well, puts a lot of pressure from a young age. So yeah, really interesting to kind of think about the way that that's different than those previous generations. But I guess in talking about that as well, in these significant factors that are impacting Gen Alpha, I know you touched on it before the pandemic and how, you know, naturally that'd be impactful and potentially contribute to them being perceived as anxious as well. But how would you say that the pandemic did impact Gen Alpha? What have we looked into in that regard?
Yeah, so we wanted to investigate what people's perceptions was of the pandemic and the impact of it on Gen Alpha. So we found that half of Australians believe the pandemic has increased Gen Alpha's reliance on screens. And this belief is even more prevalent, again, among those who know a Gen Alpha. So 58% of those who know a Gen Alpha hold this view, compared to 39% of those with no connection to Gen Alpha. So again, when people who actually know kids of this generation are more likely to say that, I feel like that's when you sit up and listen, you go, these are, they're the authority in some ways, because they are living with, or, you know, leading or educating or interacting with these kids. And oftentimes I think about how before the pandemic we were all living in a digitally integrated world, but when you make school online and work online, like, the Wi-Fi symbol, we joke, is a scary symbol. And the pandemic kind of made it like a really necessary symbol to, like, go to school and do your work and, you know, to function in society. So I feel like what COVID did was exacerbate this path we were kind of already on as a society, and even as a generation of young children, in terms of that interaction with technology and reliance on screens. And they needed it to play with their friends and see their friends and family. Like, it was just such a really interesting time for all of us. But when you think about that for children, that they can't go out and play in the park with their friends and, you know, so interesting to think about that. And that's what Australians have picked up in this study. 2 in 5 Australians think the pandemic has made it more difficult for Gen Alpha to socialise or make friends. And 2 in 5 Australians believe the pandemic delayed Gen Alpha's learning development due to disrupted schooling. And that is what I have heard a lot around the place, in terms of going out and speaking at events and speaking to the education sector particularly, and a lot of teachers that I know who are my friends, but also those who I've just kind of met and through networking at events and things like that, or if I've spoken at an event, people come up afterwards and tell stories and reflections on the stats and things like that. They say oftentimes there has been kind of this delay of learning. And I did read in one particular Harvard study that one person has calculated, and this is hard to make an average across all schools, and I think it was a particular stage of primary school, but it was like they'd lost 6 months of learning because, you know, we rely so heavily on teachers in classrooms to know when students are struggling or to help, and teachers can give that one-on-one individual feedback and nurturing, but in a Zoom environment where all the kids are online and then parents have been asked to come in and help and make sure things are getting done, and, you know, so kind of dispersing that out, that care and that education, which we had to do at the time. No one's blaming anyone here, but it's just saying, well, there has been an impact on this for young kids in their learning and their development and social skills. So that's the perception. And in contrast, the statements Australians were least likely to agree with were that the pandemic led to increased resilience among Gen Alpha. So 14% said that. 14% said a greater appreciation for family time, and 16% greater appreciation for outdoors. And then those with no connection to a Gen Alpha were more likely to say the pandemic has not impacted them, compared to those who know a Gen Alpha. So I guess the inverse of that kind of double negative is that those who know a Gen Alpha are more likely to say that it did have an impact. So again, when we listen to those who actually know kids rather than just make assumptions about a generation they might not interact very much with. That's important. But I guess, yeah, when we first ran some studies back in the years of COVID and the pandemic, we were kind of hypothesizing and people were making kind of informed assumptions and telling us, oh yeah, like it's going to be a return to family time and because, you know, that's the main connection and households and that sort of thing. But it was interesting to see in this study that that was one of those statements that people were less likely to agree with, that only 14% said COVID has resulted in a greater appreciation for family time. So I'm sure there are some situations and contexts where that is the case, where there was a greater appreciation. And even when you think about it, like that time when, you know, if you were a Gen Alpha child in a household where both parents were working or one parent was a fly-in, fly-out person or they travelled heaps and they were at home more, you'd be like, oh, wow, it's like people – I don't know if this is a fair comparison to compare a child to a pet, but you know when people got pets.
That's all right. We'll roll with that. We'll roll with that.
And, you know, the pets had like separation anxiety because they just gotten used to their owner being home with them at all times. I guess for kids it's like – they got used to that season of being at home with their parents and the whole family unit. If that was a healthy place for them, then, you know, that would have had an impact. But we are talking about young kids. And I think it was also interesting, I mean, my own perspective, based on the research I've done around Gen Alpha, is that they are a resilient generation. Yeah. And, you know, I think the fact that not many people have viewed that in this study is quite interesting. But children are always resilient and they bounce back, and COVID was tough. We're not denying that. And we can see that in some of these responses. But yeah, it was interesting to kind of see how Australians have viewed the impact of that with regards to a range of different kind of levels of impact.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, it's hard to imagine that something that has had such a significant impact on every generation that's lived through, you know, the last few years, that it wouldn't have a strong impact. And I mean, we're not perhaps even far enough removed from it to see the full scope of everything that's going to happen. I know that so much of this we're looking into, what do we think it will be? But and I mean, just a quick note, not to go too much into the psychology realm. Like you said, we're staying within our expertise. But what you were even just talking about with your funny comparison of the pet. But where I think is really interesting is I remember reading when you talk about attachment styles, like within people, and it's so much of it comes from child development, that one of the I guess ways, from what I remember, so maybe don't quote me on this, but from what I remember of reading about that and the psychology behind it, the way that the anxious attachment style can develop is not necessarily from an actual experience. It could be, but an experience of absence or isolation, but the perception of absence or isolation. So like what you just said there, where, you know, you might have a pet and then you leave and the pet doesn't have the awareness to know, oh, you're just going to the grocery store. They are just, oh, you're gone, right? And then you come back, oh, okay, thank goodness you're back. I just think all the more so with the child, you know, who's experiencing the pandemic, it's like we can have the cognitive understanding of what's happening, why the world's shutting down, why we're going on Zoom, why I'm not seeing my friends every day. And you can kind of explain it to children, but it does make me think even in that sense as well, it's there was obviously a lot of aspects of the pandemic and things that were frightening and instability, that's something we can all recognize, but it does make me think as well with children who don't have that same ability to reconcile or understand how the world works, and especially not when big significant events happen like that, how much more perhaps perceived danger or insecurity or loss maybe than what might actually have happened. So that's where it will just be interesting to kind of see how that develops. And I totally agree, though. I don't think there should be only emphasis on, I guess, the negative aspect of the anxiousness or the insecurity that might come from this sort of thing, but the resilience of living through such a tough and challenging time for anyone. But when you're a child and might not have that understanding, to have the resilience and adaptability as well will hopefully be things to come from that also. But I guess looking, you know, reflecting, of course, on the past and things that we've seen over the last few years, it's also important to look to the future. And you being a futurist yourself, Ash, I think it'd be great to just take a quick look as we close up here on what do you hypothesize, or what do we hypothesize Gen Alpha's impact to look like in the years ahead?
It's a Hard one to definitively say. And I am kind of conscious of being too prescriptive because, you know, we're still yet to see Gen Alpha like come through with their own ideas because, and we're starting to see that with the oldest of them, like even with that Sephora kind of craze and the cologne, it's like they're starting to like have their own agency because they are getting to that age where they can start creating content and we can hear more of their voice. Whereas, as I said, even like for as researchers, it is difficult and expensive to access younger kids. So I think as the generation gets older, you know, we will see. But in terms of just their impact, I mean, this digital kind of competence and intuitiveness kind of combined, I think, with, you know, even just that word like consumeristic, which I know can have a lot of negative connotations to it potentially, but just even the fact that Generation Alpha, we've already seen, are starting to have kind of economic impacts even beyond kind of their age. And again, we saw that through that Sephora and cologne kind of looking into the expensive products and end of town. And it's easy to do when you're not spending your own money, as we have appreciated on the podcast, if parents are allowing that to happen. But even like our estimation, we did some research and projections for the Harvard Business Review, and our prediction was that by the end of this year, an estimated US $5.39 trillion will be spent annually on this demographic. So that's, of course, by like their parents and their kids kind of saying, as well as like, you know, things that need to be bought for children like nappies and education and stuff, but also Gen Alpha kind of speaking up and saying, well, I want this, well, I want this particular toy or product or whatever it might be. So yeah, it's, I think we're going to see them kind of come through and be pretty engaged with the world around them. I do think they will have probably more language and knowledge about mental health, about emotional intelligence was another big kind of trend that we've started to see even among parenting, talking about your emotions and your feelings and owning that and having agency with that. So there are a couple of the aspects. And the other one is, I guess, the environmental kind of focus, which we've explored a little bit. That was the third way, most way, after digital engagement and concern with physical appearance that people in Australia had said that Gen Alpha are more likely to exhibit kind of an environmental awareness than their own generation. And we've seen this with 4 in 5 parents, so 79%, saying that their children have influenced them to be more environmentally aware in their consumption decisions. So they're calling out their parents' kind of non-environmental behaviour, like where's your keep cup and why aren't we recycling?
Why are you using plastic straws?
Exactly.
It's not a paper straw.
Exactly. And we have seen this for a couple of years, and I remember investigating this last year in our Generations Defined study, and it was just interesting to see that even just like what kids are learning about today in shows and movies and entertainment around like diversity and care for the environment and talking about your feelings and even like sexual identity. Like there's just all these themes that kids are learning about from the youngest of ages today. And we compared that to baby boomers, and it was like 3% of that whole generation had said they were learning about that when they were kids. So again, when you appreciate, oh, okay, it's a different time, it's a different context, that's why younger people value this and that's why older generations can't understand it. It's because they were shaped in really different times. So yeah, I think it'll be interesting. I mean, that kind of tech savviness, that consumer focus on the environment, focus on mental health and emotional intelligence, I think, are some of the real positives. And my personal belief, as I said and kind of peppered throughout the conversation, is, you know, yes, Gen Alpha are going to come across their own unique challenges as every generation has come across. But even though we might have these perceptions that they might be having and possessing some negative qualities, whether that's from the pandemic or social media or whatever is the cause, being aware of those challenges and potential negatives is important, but also not focusing on that and not kind of putting that over a generation, but actually allowing them to come to the table with their own kind of ways and solutions. And like you mentioned, even with, you know, Roblox and Minecraft and Fortnite, like these games that kids have been playing for years, they are co-creators, they are building worlds, they're not as passive. And so even it'll be interesting to see how empowered they are. And, you know, we joke about even like Gen Z and how entitled they are with the workplace, and they're so confident. And I just think it'll be interesting to see how much more potentially Gen Alpha might be because of the context that's shaped them. So
absolutely.
Yeah, fascinating to see. And I'm excited to hear more from Gen Alpha themselves as they get a little bit older as well.
Absolutely. Really interesting insights there, Ash. I think there's lots to think about. Even I know for me, some things that came up in this study or challenge my perceptions or get me to think more around, you know, things that have impacted Gen Alpha as I'm starting to see so much more dialogue about it. It's really interesting to think about these external factors and what other people are perceiving. Really fascinating as well what you had highlighted there in how it had gotten segmented between people that have Gen Alphas in their life versus non-Gen Alpha, and that not having Gen Alphas in their life, and just maybe we should be also listening to those parents, teachers, people who, you know, are experiencing this firsthand and have a perhaps a finger on the pulse of what's going on a bit there as well. But really interesting to chat today, Ash. Thank you for sharing all of these wonderful insights from the report so wonderfully. And yes, thanks very much.
Oh, my pleasure, Holt. And thanks again for jumping into the host seat as well.
Absolutely. Always a delight to Ash. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, you can follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.